two back doors as you exit, so feel free to drop your offerings to the Lord in there. This last Friday, we had 34 people going to the Jesus Revolution movie, and it was a real good time. And a few of us afterwards got together and had some fellowship with coffee and pie. So guys, we're planning things ahead to do some other stuff for fellowship. Pray about it, because that was a neat time of fellowship, being together as a church, getting to know one another, sitting by somebody you didn't know real well, but it was really a neat time. So if you're not going to be a part, you're going to miss out on a lot, because we have a lot of things that we're working on. We're looking at some new ministries that we're going to get started, some new Bible studies we want to get started, some outreach. So this year, we're planning a lot. So pray where the Lord would have you be as far as being part of ministry, because that's a neat time of fellowship, potlucks, and doing all kinds of neat things together as a church. Okay. We are going to have a church work day Saturday, March 11th. It's going to be things on the inside of the church and the school. Touch up, clean up, little painting here, little fixing here. So mark that on your calendar. It's going to be a neat time again. That's last time we had a work day. It was fellowship. We had fun, throwing things at each other and chasing each other around the thing. It was just a neat time. So guys, mark that on your calendar. March 11th, we're having a work day. If you look to the left of your bulletin, you'll see the Bible studies and the small group that are there Monday. The foundation class is 6:30, and that's with George. There's a phone number there. It's a neat time for anybody who just wants to get a foundation in the Lord, growing in the Lord. We also have a men's discipleship on Tuesday. That's here in the school building, 7 o'clock. Tuesday also, there's a women's morning study. There's a phone number there. You can get more information. There's also a women's Bible study here Tuesday night here at the school. Wednesday night is our Wednesday night study. This Wednesday, we're going through Ephesians. We'll be looking at praying in the Spirit with understanding. So it's going to be a neat study on prayer. So if you're not busy on Wednesday night, feel free to come in and be a part of what God's doing here on Wednesday night. We have a small time of fellowship with coffee and cookies and brownies and cake. So it starts at 6:30 and the study will start somewhere around 7. So come on in and have a neat time of fellowship. Thursday, men's Bible study in the sanctuary right up there in the upper room, and that's 6:30 in the morning. Saturday, the church comes together and prays. Guys, we get here at 6:30. Again, we have coffee and donuts, but we spend the time praying for our church, praying for the things that the Lord's going to do in the fellowship, for the fellowship, upcoming events. We pray for each other. So it's a neat time to get together and come to go before the Lord, because our church does not move on anything but prayer and God's Spirit. So we pray that God's Spirit will move into our church. Okay, I think that's it. So why don't you stand up, walk across the room, find somebody you don't know, and say, good morning, God bless you.
Why don't we all stand up and we're going to pray and praise the Lord. Father God, we come to you this morning, and it's our desire to worship you in spirit and truth. And we just want to draw closer to you. May your spirit touch us and lead us and guide us. In Jesus' name.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. And blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name,
Jesus.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name,
Jesus.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, blessed be your glorious name.
Give.
You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, blessed be your name. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, blessed be your name,
Jesus.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, blessed be your name,
Jesus.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, blessed be your glorious name.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise you, Lord.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescued the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts are hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the
one we adore. You give the healing and strength, Son.
Our hearts always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne.
You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for.
Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise.
You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
You can be seated if you'd like, or you can keep standing, whatever you would like to do.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you.
Sing it out to him now.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead. my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation.
I will put my trust
in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Oh, I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation.
I will
put my trust in you alone, and I
sing holy.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation.
I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Oh, I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation.
I will
put my trust in you alone,
and I will not be shaken. Ooh, I will build my life for you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious, dear, that grace appeared the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns. Amazing love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. Our chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest. We praise your holy name. As Pastor Tim comes to preach the word, we pray that it would speak to our hearts and we would be doers of the word. And everybody said,
Amen.
All right, junior high and high school are dismissed. You guys need Bibles. We have them available. We open our Bibles here and kind of stay on one verse for about a half an hour. So,
amen.
Amen. Preach it out. Oh, worship is a neat way to start teaching. I don't know who thought that up, but worship's a good thing. I think it has something to do with a requirement, and it is good to worship the Lord. And just to remind ourselves of our great salvation, let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the day that you've given us. We thank you for your word that, Lord, it does guide us, it does lead us, it directs us, it tempers us, Lord God. It encourages us. And Father, we come before you this morning with full acknowledgement and such awe of the scriptures and such awe of your Holy Spirit, which teaches us, Lord God, and helps us to go out in that world and be all we can be for you, Lord God. May we find application this morning. May your Spirit convict us. May your Spirit encourage us. May your word in every way sink deeply in our hearts, Lord God. Father, we ask that you join us, and we ask that you open our hearts, open our minds, and open us, Lord God, to hear from you. In Jesus' name, amen. It's good to see you all here this morning. That's a good thing, you know. And we all made the decision to come this morning. That's why you're here, you know. And it was your free will choice. I don't think anybody forced you unless, you know, somebody suggested. But we made it here. And I'm here too because I decided it'd be a good thing to do to come this morning. You know? I got up this morning and says, what if I don't show up? Now, that wouldn't be a good thing to do, you know. But decisions are something that we make daily. And this is the thing, is you get deep thoughts here at Calvary Chapel Nampa. Decisions are something that we make daily. Have you ever heard that before? Deep. No. But I say this for a segue, okay, into our discussion in the Word of God. That every one of us, this is a decision that we all make every day, no matter who you are. I guess I can't say no matter who you are. There are some, anyway, let's just keep going. All right. Every one of us has to make, every one of you have to make this decision, whether we like it or not, okay? And whether we plan to or not, plan it out or not plan it out, but we have to do it every day because we really have no choice. There's laws against this, okay? It's the decision on what to wear. What am I going to put on today? At times, for some people, it can be paralyzing. Me, for instance, I have to match my clothes. My wife is not here. She's in the Sunday school, so I'll get away with stuff. Okay. But there's decisions you make according to what's going on in your life. You know, is it clean? Is it fairly clean? Is it okay? It doesn't stink, okay? I'm talking to guys, you know, especially we all know stuff, okay? What are we going to put on? At the times, it can be hard to make that decision and to think out according to the day. I'm not going to wear tux to work, you know. And it's other different things. If I'm going to go to a killer job interview, it's a good thing that I kind of like wear something that looks appropriate, you know, that doesn't have holes in it and doesn't, you know, have stains in the front, like a mustard stain, stuff like that. You got to consider these things, okay? Or the first date for the one. I mean, even for a lady, that's the first date for that special person, or a guy. You know, all of those different things you want to put in good. So you think about what you're going to wear. 4th of July party. What colors are you going to have? Oh, let's think. Red and white and blue. Okay, we got that. All right. How about opera night? When we go to the opera, what do you guys wear? What? Am I teaching a bunch of rednecks? Okay, we are in Idaho. All right. I'm not insinuating anything, so just, I don't want to hurt feelings, okay? Beach day, what are you going to wear? Tuxedo, of course, okay? Christmas party. It's a wedding, and you're the bride. Now, that's one where probably the most thought goes through. The guys generally are like, looks good, all right, fine. But the most thought and the most money. But it's the most amazing day ever. To me, doing many, many weddings, you know, it is, every bride is beautiful. Every bride has a glow. It is a special day. To me, if it's the dress up, that one is precious. So we've got these different things. And it is our daily choice. It's either this or that. It's either this will match or that match, or I'll throw something on and just go. Now, it's been happening. Well, this has been a problem since fig leaves, okay? So it's one of those things that you make it happen. It's the daily thing of what we all do and have been doing most of our lives. Can you remember the first day that you put on something? No. Now, nowadays, we've got video for everything. I mean, a kid can't grow up without, boy, the first of all these things. But I know that what I have observed, and I'm probably sure I did the same thing, when I was able to put a shirt on, was it inside out? Was it front or back? Probably didn't matter. I got it on. And the first pants you put on, you know, backwards, they're on. And your shoes. It sometimes takes a lot of people, you know, 5, 6, 7, up to 10 on the right shoes on what side, okay? But it's this whole thing of the elementary aspects. Upside down, wrong foot, dirty, clean, holy, new, it didn't matter. You just practice putting clothes on. And Paul is instructing the Colossian church, and he's using this illustration to put off the old man and his deeds and to put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge. So that's the thing. When you want to do these things, let's step into these clothes, okay? We are in Colossians chapter 3, verse 9. I don't feel comfortable with this leather jacket. I feel like I'm showing off. So I want to get into something more comfortable, if you guys don't mind. This is comfortable. The buttons are missing, but it's okay. You know, when you do props, that means you got nothing. Okay, so I got nothing today. I like this thing, especially in Idaho weather, you know. Sometimes it's a little cold, just throw this baby on. Don't worry about what happens to it, because like I say, buttons are missing and that type of deal. But it's comfortable, you know. So let's do this. We read verse 9. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds. It tells us to put off. Now we take this word. I just took that jacket off, okay? It was hot anyway, you know? And it means this, to wholly put off, to fully put off from oneself. And denoting separation from what is put off. To wholly put off. And then it goes, what to put off? It's to put off the old. What's the old? Okay? To wholly take it off, to fully take it off, okay? Denoting separation from that thing is no longer on me, okay? And it's to put off the old, which is no longer new, worn by use, the worse for wear. So you're taking something off that is worn out, not any good. And I'm being opposite here, but here's it. Our old grubbies, we can put on for dirty work. We can put on whatever we need because we know it's not going to be good. We put on with full intentions to embrace the filth without a care. So as you realize, these things are not going to work anymore. And with full intention, to note, these are the things that Paul is telling them what to take off, the old man, and what to put on, and the reasons why. That's the visual that Paul paints for the Corinthian church. The visual is the old man is useless. The old man is a filthy rag, worn out and useless to heaven. So this is the thing. I take this off, you know, because I recognize this isn't going to work anymore. I had some pants I was going to put on, but I can't do that. But I will show you. This is what I put on when I paint. Do you know why they're all nasty like that? Because I put them on when I paint. Deep again. But they're not good for anything. This stuff won't come out. So these are the things. Now you realize. We realize what Paul is putting forward. He's using this illustration. I'm trying to simplify it because I'm a little simple, okay? But here's this thing is it's like it's worn out. It's used up. It's no good for heaven. I can't go anywhere there unless it's marsing, you know? And we realize this. The visual is that he points us, this old man is useless. It is like a filthy rag. And that's the word. Our old man resists godly change. And we put this thing off. And the word man means universal for men and women. The old man. Put off. Put off the old man. Put off the old man with his deeds. And then verse 10. And put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him. That's the part, you guys. That's to put on, and this is what I love. And the word of God you hold in high regard, and you hold in high regard of original language, the original words, original meaning, so that we can grasp it to the depth that needs to be grasped, okay? To put on means this, to sink into, to put on, to clothe oneself. to sink into your favorite outfit, to sink into something that is new. Because new clothes are just nice, you know. It's like, I like my new clothes. And the thing is this, to sink into. Sometimes we can, from the very beginning, I can put my Jesus t-shirt on backwards, but I'm wearing it. I can have the wrong shoes on with one sock, but I'm making progress. Backwards pants can be a start. We are learning how to be clothed with Christ because we can pull up this old thing and that, there's different things. We are to put this off, not to put it back on. We are to put on Christ to keep that off. And as we sink into, and that's a good word, as we sink into this life with Jesus and we put on Christ and as we clothe ourselves in Christ, and recognize what that really, really means, because we have a new name. We have a new identity, and you got to get used to that. The old is gone. Behold, all things have become new. As we put on these things, as we clothe ourselves with Christ, people can see that you have new clothes. People can see that you've changed your image. You've gotten style. People can see that there's something different about you. Well, it's my new shirt. I just got it on. It's backwards, but it's new, right? These are the beginnings of the recognition of putting on Christ. And then the thing is, yeah, I got new clothes, and this is where I bought them at. And I exchanged these ugly, it was a free exchange. I gave them these and they gave me this. You know, this is the stuff, it's the great exchange as you put off. That thing's died at Calvary. And the new life in Christ is because of Calvary. And this is a simple illustration, but being a new believer in Christ Jesus is simple. It is a decision. This is what I'm going to do. This is amazing grace, how sweet the sound. I was a wretch, and now I'm all of these things. This is the simplicity of it, the changed life in Christ. As we are renewed, again, going back to this new word, and we have put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him. As we are renewed, which means to cause, to grow up, to be new, to be made new, to cause, to grow up. The beginning of the life in Christ, you are a baby in Christ. You are a babe. And you learn and you grow in Christ and you grow in the knowledge of his word and the application of his word. It starts from day one and you're not the cleanest. It took a while for a lot of things to clean out of my life and probably yours too. But God dealt with me with one issue at a time. And as we grow and apply and allow the word to train us and allow the word to enlighten us and to show us what pleases God, as we do these things, God does an amazing work in our heart and in our outer person. As we sink into this new life with Christ, to make new, to be changed, and going again to renewed, it means to be changed into a new kind of life as opposed to the former corrupt state. This is the aspect, because we are continually being changed into the image of Christ. How does that happen? You got to know your Bible. But not just memorize all the addresses. That's great. but apply and see it working on a consistent basis as you are applying by faith, he will faithfully show up and do things in your life to enhance your walk with him, to encourage you, to build your faith that I know that God hears my prayers because he's shown me many, many times. And that must be, has to be, a testimony of believers. Has God been faithful to you? That would be yes. Could he be more faithful to you? No. We wish that he would not leave us stranded to go through the trials, the tribulations, and afflictions, but that's needed. It's funny, the righteous are afflicted. Why is that? Because there is gold in the midst of affliction. There are things that we learn when we're at our bottom and we have nowhere else to turn but to trust him. These are the things that he's doing in and through us because he wants our betterment. He wants us to walk forward, to walk by faith and not by sight. That's powerful. And also this is that we have put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him. What is this knowledge? Knowledge is this. We go back to the original word. Precise and correct knowledge. We get that from the word of God. Precise and correct knowledge. It's used in the New Testament of the knowledge of all things ethical and divine. This is the connotation. Precise and correct knowledge used in the New Testament of the knowledge of things ethical and divine. That's what a new life in Christ is all about. When I got saved, this Bible came alive. When I got saved, this Bible showed me what honesty, integrity, and honor was all about. It showed me what sexual purity was about. It showed me what being a man of his word is about. It showed me so many things. How to stay my keep pure. Then, you know, how to be a husband, how to be a dad, how to be a brother in Christ. All of these different things. These are the processes that we all go through, and we realize that. It's what we are. It's biblically defined. Because the Bible defines our ethnos. It defines our ethic. And it guides us. And it guides all believers. The Word of God is the knowledge of all things ethical and divine. And it's the application. It's always this. You apply this thing in your life. And you will walk away with some things. Biblical definitions of life. And all the questions that are given us in life. We've got biblical direction on everything you want to talk about outside of the church setting. We have a worldwide ethic that we get as believers. No matter where you come from, the Bible speaks this whole thing into each of us. And it allows us and helps us to deal with the culture we're in the middle of. This one, Chinese, whatever the nationality, whatever the background, whatever is ruling these different places, the Word of God is lifting up the believers. From babes to mature to, in many respects, becoming productive for the kingdom of God. Don't ever get locked into our American mentality. We've got our own problems. But so do our brothers and sisters all over the place. And that's the part where we realize this. Because the Word of God gives us biblical definition of life and all questions that are given to us and through us. Divine knowledge of God turns into wisdom as we openly apply knowledge in our daily occupation. We are to occupy before he comes. And as we just apply, put his word, and go from day to day and keep learning and growing and letting his word define where we stand on so many things. And what's it look like biblically to put on Christ? as we put on Christ. What does that look like? So turn with me to Romans chapter 13, verse 11. That, it jumped out at me when I was studying. Okay, Romans 13, verse 11. Okay, here's Paul's suggestion here. And this, and do this. Oh, that's not a suggestion. No, sir. Sorry about that. And do this, and do this. Knowing the time. And now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than we first believed. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts. Now is high time to wake up from your sleep. Now, do you guys wake up with alarm clocks? Some do, okay? Alarm clock people, all right? Now, when you're an alarm clock person, are you just the one snooze guy? Just one snooze, or lady? Two snoozes. Is it when it first goes off, you're there? Or you're like, four snooze, I forget, you know? But there's this different thing. Or you the person that wakes before the alarm goes off. It's like, oh, it's an hour and a half before the alarm goes off, and I'm fully awake. Why did I set that alarm? I'll wait for it to go up. No, I can't do that. I'll wake somebody up. But God's alarm bells are ringing, you guys. It's a worldwide thing. It's set. I guess it's not ringing, but you know we're getting close. I know God's alarm bell will be a big trumpet sound. Okay, but as we set our alarms because we have some place to go. We set our alarms because we have somewhere that we have to be at a certain time. So we don't stay asleep when we're supposed to be where we need to be. We set our alarms because we don't want to be late. We set our alarms because we want to be on time. We set our alarms because we want to be on schedule. We don't want to miss the plane. We don't want to miss the train. We don't want to miss the appointment. We don't want to miss that date. It's important enough for us to set an alarm. It's important enough for us to set the alarm so that we can show up. Paul is telling them to wake up. And you got to remember, this was a long time ago. Paul is referring to us today. Our salvation is nearer than we first believed. And do this, knowing the time is now at, I'll start over. And do this, knowing the time, that now is a high time to awake. It's a good time to wake up. To awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than we first believed. Paul wrote this in 57 AD. 13 years later, Israel was obliterated. Jerusalem was razed. It was a pile of rubble. Millions of Jews died. Millions of Jews were dispersed throughout the Roman Empire, and Israel was no more. They changed its name to Philistia. They changed everything. And what happened to the believers during this? See, these are the things he's telling them. The Spirit's showing this man. I mean, really, if you think about it, the politics of the day in Rome was bad. And the aspect of what he's wanting to do with the church is grow it up and wake it up. so that they would be ready in many respects. Because what's crazy, with all of that persecution, with all of that stuff, with Christianity being outlawed, the catacombs, all those different things, the church spread. Christianity spread in the midst of all that. Because of this, because of all of the things that Paul put into and all the apostles that put into these the early church and the generations from that. So this is the thing. There's always those deals. Our salvation is nearer than we think when we first believed. And let's just do this. You got to think about it. Why is that there? Why did he word it this way? And do this, knowing that the time, that now is high time to awake out of sleep, for now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. When I stop and pause at just that, I think about day one when I first believed. I think about the first year, the second year, the third year when I first believed, the zeal that was in my heart. Don't let that fire burn out. Don't let that intrigue and the wonderment of his word become something that you used to do. Don't think this Bible doesn't really need to be studied and read because I know it. No, you don't. None of us do. Do you have a desire for his word? And these are the questions that we all have to ask. These are here for our consideration. It always is for our consideration. That was 2,000 years ago when Paul put that together. I think, I'm going to go out on a limb, I think we're a little closer now than in Paul's time. You can quote me on that, okay? But that's the whole part. And verse 12 says this, because he's going farther. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. The night is far spent. Let's just pause here just a tad bit. Is it a little dark out there? There's darkness all over the place. There's so many different things. The night is far spent, and the day is at hand. As you recognize, we see this. The day is at hand, which means this. What are you going to do with the data that you're seeing around you? But here's what I think is great. Because we have this, and this is hope for us. This is the thing that we have somewhere to go, and we have the ability to get there. Therefore, let us, as we recognize and we see and we do in many respects, we always have to check our heart before the Lord, to check our heart before the Word. Does it line up with what God's saying right here? Therefore this, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. When it says let us, it means it's us empowered by the Holy Spirit to cast off these things. It's the same word as Colossians 3:8, put off the old man. It's the exact same thing. And we're able to do that because now I know what sin is. There were things that I did I had no conscience about. I could never do them today because of the Holy Spirit. Because what God's put in each of us, we know right from wrong. We know all these things. And we know the Word of God is powerful like a two-edged sword. It keeps us out of trouble. But it's therefore. It means we can be empowered. We can do it. Yes, we can. That's Bob the Builder quote. I got to hand that to my grandson, Jay. He loved that song. We can do it. Yes, we can. You know what? We can grow in Christ. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. And he's empowered us to do that. We are able to cast off the works of darkness. We are able to recognize the works of darkness. When they come in subtly, when they come in all disguised about this and that, we are able to discern and to see what at one time we couldn't. Here's the thing. The works of darkness, it can be harmless in our eyes. It's like having a pet black widow in a jar. Well, if you don't like that, it's like having a diamondback rattlesnake in an aquarium. What's wrong with that? Snakes have soft eyes. Don't quote me on that. They never blink. But what could possibly happen with the black widow in a jar? What could possibly happen with a snake in an aquarium? The spider loves me. I can tell. I just let it crawl on me. It's just, I think it really likes me. You're dumb, okay? Why did my hand just fall off, okay? The snake is okay because it's kind of cold and doesn't move much. But if I carry it around, it gets all warm and bites me right in the jugular vein. So these are the things. It's defining. Oh, that's not that bad. It's just a tiny, I got it contained. And I'll just, you know, when nobody's around, I'll just talk to it, you know. And these are the things. These are the things that we have to be careful about. It can be harmless in our eyes. And you think, the spider really does love me, I can tell. But here's the thing is, we can put that stuff off and we can identify it. And then we can put on the armor of light. That also is the same word as Colossians 3:9. We can put on the new man. These are not, this is basic growing in Christ 101. Because when we put on the armor of light, it's shiny, it's bright, people can see it. And it's an offensive piece of clothing to take territory. It's protective. But in this thing, it's this. Every Christian, it's forward motion. It's forward motion. Do not shrink back. Do not shrink back. Keep going. I'm discouraged. Well, praise the Lord. What are you going to learn by that? They said bad things about me and hurt my feelings. You know? Well, what did they do with Jesus? But he tells us. Protective forward mode. Because why? Because of the knowledge of our mission. Our mission hasn't changed for 2,000 years. When Paul said that, the commission that Jesus gave all of us hasn't changed. It still hasn't changed. Nations have risen and nations have fallen. Injustice has been running rampant in so many ways. Historical aspects of butchery and the evilness of men, it's never ceased. It's just more people now. Then it tells us we can put this stuff off and we can put on the armor of light. Verse 13 says, another one, we now can do this. You can't do this as a not saved person. But we can do this because the Holy Spirit lives in us, empowers us to do it, opens our eyes, enlightens us to recognize and identify this thing is not any good for me. I need to take care of it. It will bite me in the throat or my hand will fall off. See, these are the things. This is the elementary part that we all have to realize. It takes effort. But let us do this. Verse 13, let us walk properly as in the day. Not in revelry and drunkenness. Let us walk properly. I cannot walk properly in my own strength. Because if I do, I will fall. If I say, I am really doing a good job walking properly, I don't really need to pray anymore because I got it down. These things, pride will get you, and pride is subtle. Pride is how the enemy fell. I am empowered to walk properly. And when I walk properly, I cannot pat my own back because it can't reach very good. Let us walk properly. It's only by the power of the Holy Spirit in us that we can walk properly as in the day. I don't know. I still think this. As in the day is a suggestion of when you first believed. How far have you allowed God to go in your life since the day? Or how far have you compromised your life or the Word of God since that day? I say these things not to like, I just want, like, I'm going to go home feeling rotten. No, these are the things that we all as believers have to deal with. Because if Satan can't keep you from going, if he can keep you from going forward, he will definitely want to keep you on your laurels. He can give us such ability to be comfortable. And it's easy. I like that comfortable outfit. It feels good. But it's not really good for going out and touching the world. Shiny armor is a lot better. It's more impressive. Here's the thing. My shiny armor, I just can't say, well, yeah, I shined it. Nope, God shined it. All of these things, all these attributes. Verse 13b is this. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in revelry, not in drunkenness, not in lewdness, not in lust, not in strife, and not in envy. Don't walk in revelry. Don't walk in drunkenness. Don't walk in lewdness and lust or strife or envy. Well, that's just clear. Everybody knows that. Oh, yes, they do. And this is the problem that we have as Christians, especially in America, is this mentality. What do these words really mean? Revelry. It can turn into a thing. Drunk? What does that mean? I'm not drunk. I've only had a few beers. As a matter of fact, I'm not drunk. I could drink a fifth all day long and not be drunk. These are the things. It's the funniest deal how we can just mess around with stuff. With definition of words, lewdness is relative. I mean, come on. You say it's lewd, I say it's not. You say it's this, I say it's, you know, we've got all those, we have that stuff. There's no such thing as truth. Yes, there is. Lust is also your definition. And the definition is very debatable. Strife? Well, who can call that? This is now strife. This is now drunkenness. This is, well, how do you get the, it's these things, because we can justify so much. And we can carry a lot of this stuff around and not even realize that thing is strife. That thing is lewd. That thing's not right. Because we all have that tendency to justify all sorts of stuff. Envy. Come on. You don't know I'm envious. I don't think I'm envious. You're being judgmental by calling me that. It's always this. I don't care what other people will perceive. It is you having an honest heart before God with the Word of God in front of you. And that will define. That will give you the ethnos. That will give you knowing full well the Holy Spirit is not going to let you be deceived that way. Because that spider in the jar, somebody didn't put the lid on tight. you know, when you fell asleep, the jar fell off, and that spider's up your nose. And there's nothing you can do. Then your head falls off, okay? Here is the thing. Here is what we're supposed to do. Verse 14. We are to do this. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts. So I take all these things. I can put my jacket on. I'm getting a little chilly. Okay? I can put this back on. And to make no provision for the flesh. I can now do this. You can now do this. To make no provision nor forethought of the flesh. No, I can do this and I can do that. Then I'll plan on a little me time. Me and my spider are going to have a chat, okay? Or I'll stew on this and I'll think about that, how I was wronged and now I'm angry. I can do all these different things that Paul is putting together, because all these things are an end product, but how do you get there in all these aspects? Put on Christ and make no provision for the flesh, no forethought, no all these different things. It's no, I'll do this or that. Always believe this. That us as believers have a responsibility to not make any provision for the flesh. There is a maintenance aspect of it all. If you forget prayer, you forget your word, you just keep rolling, you can do that. You're free to do that. But you will find that the consequences of your neglect of His word, of walking in the Spirit, is going to hurt you. And when you realize this is painful, I've hurt somebody, all these different things, this is where God gives your attention, and He loves you. So as we come into this place, empowered by the Spirit of God, empowerment by the Holy Spirit, the Word teaches us and corrects us, and it never leaves us. Back in Colossians chapter 3. Let's go there. All right. Verse 12. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on the tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. As you build this up, as we see our condition, this is what I love about the Word of God. There's remedy. Because we all are convicted by what we just explored. But here's the things that we can do. To make no provision of the flesh is a plan on our part to do so. And however you define that, God knows your wicked heart more than you think. He also gave us power over it. Because we're not left there. We just have an awareness, and now we know what to do with it and where to take it. To make no provision is to let us walk properly. And let us cast off and let us put on the armor of God so that I can touch a world that desperately needs the armor of light, the hope that we have, the recognition that I can't do it, but Christ can do it in and through me. This is empowerment by the Holy Spirit who lives in us as believers. It teaches us. It convicts us. And we know this, the Lord would never leave us nor forsake us. We are in Christ. We are the elect of God. We are holy and we are beloved by Him. We are precious in His sight. And He wants us to put on and to sink into Christ. When this said, the elect of God, we are holy and beloved, which we are a most holy thing. That's how God sees you. And this is how you have to see you. See, and we have the ability to recognize what's in us. And that we are a saint, a most holy thing. We are beloved, which means we are welcomed by God. We're His friend. And He loves us dearly. So you have to know this. This is the motivation for you and for me not to fulfill the lusts of the flesh. It's from our spiritual core that we do this, from exactly where we live, that we are now able to love deeply one another. As we put on tender mercies, has mercy ever been extended to you? Yes. Mercy has been extended to all of us. I never want to take that for granted. And mercy comes from God. And kindness is a quality of being kind, that I am saved by grace. Therefore, as elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, and long-suffering. I can't do this without acknowledgement of this. Meekness and gentleness and mildness and long-suffering, which is endurance and a constancy, steadfastness is perseverance. Because we will have resistance as Christians. Verse 13, bearing one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. If anyone has a complaint against another, and as we are bearing and we're forgiving one another, and that's the fruit of the Spirit in us. It's what putting on Christ shows the world. We can forgive. It's all these things, to put on love, which is the bond of perfection. To put on love. I can't experience love, which is the bond of perfection. Sometimes we forget to love one another. Sometimes we have complaints and we just stay right there. It's a hard thing, because that is very interesting. Above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. It's what binds us together in a church. We all have our flaws. We all have conviction. We all have all these things. And we know we're saved by grace. We know the mercies of God. Therefore, because we know all these things, because we are not qualified, what I just went through, but we know these things. He loved me when I was yet His enemy. He forgave me from so many things that we're all ashamed to say how much He's forgiven us. And we know we've been forgiven. That's how we love one another. That is the church. That's what's kept the church. We are to know one another, our love for one another. Sometimes we can lose sight of that. Sometimes we can really get off track. But I just want to do this. Turn with me to Corinthians 13. And I just want to read this. This is the stuff that keeps things going for me, keeps things going for you. And these are the choices we make as we realize how much we are loved. It tells us this. Love suffers long, verse 4. And is kind. Love does not envy. And this is the stuff I just want to balance it all out. This is how we can do this. Love suffers long and is kind. 1 Corinthians 13:4. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself, is not puffed up. Love does not behave rudely. Love does not seek its own, is not provoked, and thinks no evil. Love does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. And love never fails. But whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put childish things away. This is us growing up in Christ. This is us recognizing what He is doing and has done and will continue to do in us. For now, we see in a mirror dimly. But then, face to face, now I know in part, and then I shall know just as I am fully known. We're going to see all the things we went through. We're going to have an answer to all the whys of life, of all the tribulations and trials and all the things that we went through. And we're going to see how much God really, truly, absolutely carried us, protected us, held us in His right hand. These are things that you realize. I can't do these things, but He can teach me to love, show me to love, and the fruit of the Spirit is love. But now, verse 13, abide, faith, hope, and love. These three, but the greatest of this is love. So as we kind of close this part of Colossians, going back to Colossians 3, sometimes the Word of God hammers you. It's uncomfortable. But that God has a plan for us. Verse 15 says this, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts. Again, we can let that happen. To rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your heart to the Lord. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of Jesus Christ. Give thanks to God the Father through Him. We can let the power of God rule in our hearts now. We can put Him in the center of everything. And to which you were called, one body, and be thankful. And let the Word of Christ dwell, live in your heart, an abode. These are the things that we bring to the table that He's empowered us to do. Dwell in you richly, in all wisdom and teaching. And admonishing one another, and encouraging, and also challenging one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual song, singing with grace in your heart to the Lord. And whatever you do, be it in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And you look at this and you say, man, what is the thing? What's our takeaway? It's simply this. As we sink into, as we put on Christ, as we clothe ourselves in Christ, as we do this thing of what would Jesus do? I mean, it's not a catchphrase. It's kind of turned into that. But it really is a real search. What would Jesus do in this situation? Search my heart. I know what I would do, but then the Lord has taught me what he would do. And what am I supposed to be? As I put on Christ, as I take the old man and leave him back there, I can love that person. I can forgive that person. I can hurt for that person. I can pray for that person. When people walk out on something that is true, you pray for that person. As we cause ourselves to grow and to be renewed, to be changed into a new kind of life as opposed to the old, then we are effective. As we have the knowledge of what this is, to apply what we know, to know who we know and why we know him and what he's done in our lives, and now we can serve him, and now we can also serve others. We can love where we couldn't love before. We can forgive where it's not possible. We can overcome things that only he can do through us. And when we do all of these things, it is what he has in store. The days are evil. We are to wake up. And when and where did it all happen? It happened at Calvary. And Calvary was the beginning of it all. The resurrection was exactly what needed to be done. So I know this is heavy, but I know this. Following the Lord and growing in Christ, the enemy does not want you to do that. He wants to keep you happy and ignorant. But awake, O sleeper, rise from the dead, you know. It's crazy out there, and I need him, and we all need him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you, God, that sometimes it's heavy and sometimes it's lighthearted, but Lord, we know that it does ring true. And Lord, whatever has spoken to, I know what's spoken to me through this, and I don't know what has spoken to anybody else, but Lord, it is exactly what we do with your word. Do we just go forward and forget about it, or do we let your spirit teach us? And Lord, we just thank you for that. We thank you for the time of worship as we just took time to just center upon you, Lord. We ask, God, that you be in our midst. We ask, Lord God, that you hold us in your arms. And Lord, we ask, God, that we can be all we can be for you. And Lord, if there is conviction here, Lord, let us just recognize the danger of compromise. And let us, in every way, just be all we can be for you. And Lord, we give you our weaknesses, we give you our heartaches, we give you our burdens, and know, Lord God, that nothing has went through our lives that has not went through your hands first. So we trust you, and we thank you, and you praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
This last song we're going to do is called Desperado. Those of you who may have been listening to music in the 70s would recognize this. It's an old Eagles tune. When I was a new Christian, I took liberties with it and kind of modified it. So I'm going to sing it. Hopefully it'll speak to your heart.
Thank you.
Desperado, why don't you come to your senses? You've been building defenses for so long now. Oh, you're a hard one. I know that you got your reasons. And like a change of the season, it's time to soften your heart. Why don't you try the King of Kings, boy? I know that you're able. You see, the great I am is always your best bet. Now it seems to me some fine things have been laid out on your table. Go on and choose the one you haven't chosen yet. Oh, desperado, oh, you ain't getting no younger. Your pain and your hunger, they're driving you home. And freedom, oh, freedom, well, that's found only in Jesus. He's the one who has freed us and he'll make you his own. But your heart's been cold as a winter time. The sky won't snow and the sun won't shine. It's hard to tell your nighttime from your day. He's called your name, whispered in the wind. Ain't it funny how we'll keep him far away? Desperado, why don't you come to your senses? Bring down your defenses. Open your heart. It may be raining, but there's a rainbow above you. You better let the Savior love you. Let the Savior love you. Better let the Savior love you before it's too late. Lord, we thank you for sending us your Savior who died an awful death on the cross to save us, Lord. And we're just so grateful for your love and compassion. Pray that everybody here will come to know you, Jesus, as their personal Savior. That, as your word says, all we have to do is believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved. So we just thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace and mercy. And as we go, as we leave this place, we pray that you would just touch us, help us to reach out, reach out to those who are lost. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.